friends, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I want to welcome you to this online service of worship for February 27th, 2022 for Riverside United Church, an affirming community of faith in London, Ontario. My name is Dave Exley, and I'm the lead minister for Riverside. And if you're wondering why this video was released a little bit later today, it's because we've returned to in-person worship. We'll continue to offer these video services for those who cannot join us in person, but for those who can, please feel free. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings, if you're able to, at Riverside, at our building, for either our 8:44 contemporary service at 8:44 in the morning, or for the 10:30 a.m. traditional service. You are more than welcome to join us in person. But today we celebrate Transfiguration Sunday. This is the Sunday that precedes the season of Lent, which begins this week on Ash Wednesday. Lent is that season of preparation as we move toward the events of Holy Week and Good Friday, and then eventually onto the Easter season. Like I do each and every year, I encourage you to consider what you might do this Lenten season to go deeper in your walk of faith. You may choose to give up something, like coffee or alcohol or sweets. You might do what I often do during the Lenten season, read through one of the Gospels as your daily faith practice. One thing you can do is participate in our Lenten Sharing and Caring Challenge. If you visit our website, there's information on this challenge issued to us by the M68 Committee, a challenge that is a little bit like a reverse Advent calendar, or in this case, a reverse Lenten calendar. All the information is on our website. Just go to the main page, scroll down, and you'll see Lent 2022. And you can click on there, and it'll have all the information that you need. Feel free to join us as we partner together in this important work. Well, this week we've been greeted by some incredibly troubling images in the newspaper and on the news as word of the Russian invasion into Ukraine sadly became a reality. While we know that prayers are not nearly enough, we cannot help but stop today and in the days ahead and offer words of light and hope in the midst of the darkness that surrounds the people who remain in Ukraine and for those who are fleeing the country. And so today we light a candle in solidarity with those who are bravely facing the invasion, for those who are in mourning, and for those who work today and in the days ahead diligently and faithfully for the cause of peace. May God's light shine into the darkness of our world.
To the fountain, dip your heart in the Reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 to 43. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. About 8 days after Jesus said these things, he took Peter, John, and James and went up on a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes flashed white like lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with him. They were clothed with heavenly splendor and spoke about Jesus' departure, which he would achieve in Jerusalem. Peter and those with him were almost overcome by sleep, but they managed to stay awake and saw his glory, as well as the two men with him. As the two men were about to leave Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it's good that we're here. We should construct these shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But he didn't know what he was saying. Peter was still speaking when a cloud overshadowed them. As they entered the cloud, they were overcome with awe.
Then a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." Even as the voice spoke, Jesus was found alone. They were speechless and at the time told no one what they had seen. The next day, when Jesus, Peter, John, and James came down from the mountain, a large crowd met Jesus. A man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to take a look at my son. My only child. Look, a spirit seizes him, and without any warning, he screams. It shakes him and causes him to foam at the mouth. It tortures him and rarely leaves him alone. I begged your disciples to throw it out, but they couldn't." Jesus answered, "You faithless and crooked generation, how long will I be with you and put up with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon threw him down and shook him violently. Jesus spoke harshly to the unclean spirit, healed the child, and gave him back to his father. Everyone was overwhelmed by God's greatness. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
And friends, let us pray. O creative God, source of all beauty, you give light to the soul. Open our hearts as we listen for your word. Open our minds as we dream with you. Reveal your life-giving truth that comforts and disturbs us through Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, there are numerous stories of resistance that have emerged from the dark days of slavery in the United States. One such story involves a song entitled "Ho, Emma, Ho." I must tell you that I am somewhat embarrassed that I wasn't aware of this song until recently, particularly because my eldest child bears the name of the song's protagonist. "Ho, Emma, Ho" was sung in the fields by enslaved black men and women as they worked. It was a song of resistance that showed care for community. Enslaved people would sing this work song, usually at a relatively slow pace, to moderate the pace of work. The idea was that everyone worked at the same speed when they sung that song together. And when they did so, it would be difficult to call out someone for not working hard enough. The leader in the field would sing,
"Oh, am I home? You turn around, dig a hole in the ground. Oh, am I home?"
And the enslaved people would follow the rhythm, singing along and working together to the beat, carefully and methodically acting together for the sake of the whole. The story offers us an image of what it means to witness a defiant, flickering flame held up against the darkness. When I heard this story from the past about this song of resistance, I couldn't help but think about the life and ministry of Jesus, the way of Christ. For in much the same way, his life, his story, and his way rings out across the centuries as a song of unity, a song of rhythmic resistance offered up in faithful defiance to an imbalanced world. The story of Transfiguration, both the ascent up the mountain and the return to the everyday world, comes to us as a kind of song of resistance that invites us to listen for the rhythm of God's dream for the world. Jesus' words ring out as a song that attempts to unite the disciples, a song designed to bring them in sync with God and with one another. And as listeners to that story, we're called to do the same. Christ's transfiguration comes to us as a prelude to the important season that we're about to enter in the church's calendar, the season of Lent. It's in this story that Jesus shifts his focus. He begins to walk toward Jerusalem for the first time, toward that place of power and privilege, toward that place of danger. He walks toward Jerusalem to challenge the corrupt and imbalanced systems of his world. Jesus, in this encounter that we just heard, takes his closest friends, Peter, John, and James, up with him to the Mount of Transfiguration. It's there that, while praying, Jesus' appearance changes. Moses and Elijah, key figures from their faith tradition, appear beside the transformed Christ. And then something strange happens. Peter and the other disciples almost fall asleep in the midst of this. It's almost as if they almost miss it, but not quite. Peter, in that moment, as so many of us remember, decides that he wants to suggest to Jesus that they remain on the mountain rather than returning to the regular world. Now, rather than rebuke Peter, Jesus simply leads him and the others down the mountain as they begin the difficult journey toward Jerusalem. The text then shifts to another healing story. When they return to the everyday world, a man comes to Jesus asking for his help. His son suffers from what he describes as a spirit that has seized him and is torturing him. The man had attempted to get the other disciples, the ones that did not accompany Jesus up the mountain, to heal him, but they failed. Jesus' response appears to be rather harsh. It seems to be, at least on the surface, judgmental and cruel. It's no wonder why some churches will leave out this section of the reading out today. But I can't help but wonder if there's more than meets the eye when it comes to this second part of the passage. Perhaps Jesus in this moment is simply being playful when he says, "You faithless and crooked generation, how long will I be with you and put up with you?" It isn't a stretch to imagine him taking this approach with those close to him. It certainly hits us differently when we add a playful tone to the remark. But what if he isn't being clever here? What if his frustration is authentic? Can you blame him for being disappointed? The disciples have the power to bring healing as well, not just Jesus. They need to be able to carry on the work of Christ in his absence. Jesus knows that his days are numbered. For God's work to continue, they need to be able to deliver, to carry on that work without him. Beyond the harsh words, though, there is a beautiful truth embedded in this section of the text. Jesus' frustration reveals to us that the power to bring peace, healing, and wholeness to the world doesn't reside only in the chosen one single, gifted individual. It exists within all of us. Jesus' emotional outburst may be jarring when we read it in that harsh way, but it reminds us that God empowers us all to bring healing and wholeness. We need to simply be persistent enough, committed enough to that shared work. Have faith that with God's help, we can do it. Do you remember what Jesus says in the Gospel of Matthew? The Message translation captures his words perfectly as we hear him say to the faithful, "Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace." This is what Jesus is attempting to do. He's teaching his followers the unforced rhythms of grace. Like a song leader guiding a field of workers in a song of resistance, he's inviting us to mirror his words and his pace. He's modeling for us what it means to carry the weight of our world together, to care for those next to us, to use our voices in an effort to rise up and transform our world. The story of the Transfiguration is not a story intended to be locked in one time and place, connected only to the moment Jesus shared with his closest friends on a mountain in Galilee 2,000 years ago. The Transfiguration is, like so many other events in the Gospel stories, it's an ongoing event that continues today. The key piece of instruction for us is to acknowledge that our peak moments of faith are worthless if we aren't willing to come down the mountain. If we aren't willing to make that journey together in an effort to partner with God and with one another in the difficult and yet important work related to transformation, healing, and wholeness. Learning the unforced rhythms of grace, it isn't easy. It requires work from us. It demands that we come down from those privileged mountain places, those places that we'd soon rather not leave, and partner with God in the critical work of creation. While we gather here, wherever you might be, in your homes, while I speak to you from my home here, there is this war that's raging in the Ukraine. Many of us in this moment, we're wondering, what can I do? It's natural to feel helpless in the midst of such heavy news. I'm sure there's some of us that have already started to respond to the darkness we've been witnessing on the news. We're praying for peace. We're posting support on social media. Perhaps we've even gone so far as to donate money, whether to the Red Cross or some other Ukrainian relief effort. All those things are good. We should do those things. But do you know what the best response is to the violence we see in the world today, and any time we see it? The best response is to say, "God, help me to do what I can to bring peace to the world around me, to my small corner of the world." We could say all the right things in prayers lifted up for the Ukrainian people, We could each make sizable donations to the Red Cross or some other relief organization. We could light peace candles in our communities of faith each and every day. But if we don't follow that up with acts of mercy and peace, words of grace and love shared with all those that we meet in our everyday lives, we will have failed in our walk of faith with God. Prayers of faith, acts of generosity, those are the mountaintop moments where the work ends for some. Jesus invites us to walk down the mountain in an effort to practice our faith in the muck and mire of the everyday world. To walk with Jesus, to commit ourselves to the kind of transformation and beauty he longed to share with the world, requires that we listen for his voice. It is a voice that guides us as we work. His song is a song of resistance that calls us into freedom, that knocks down the proud and the powerful, that interrupts systems of oppression, that silences voices of judgment, and makes us one. As we attempt to listen for and learn Christ's unforced rhythms of grace, let me close by sharing this prayer written by the great Ted Loder. The gospel writer doesn't share with us the words that Jesus spoke on the Mount of Transfiguration, but I can't help but wonder, did Jesus pray something like this? Listen to these words, this prayer written by Ted Loder. O God, turn your spirit loose now, and me with it, that I may go to where the edge is to face with you the shape of my mortality, the inescapable struggle and loneliness and pain which remind me that I am less than God after all, that you have made me with hard limits, limits to my strength, my knowledge, my days. Facing these limits, Lord, grant me the grace to live to the limit of being unflinchingly alive, irrepressibly alive, fully alive, of experiencing every fragile, miraculous, aching, beautiful ounce of being a human being, of doing my duty and a little more, of loving the people around me, my friends and my enemies, of humbling myself to take others seriously and delightedly. O God, turn your spirit loose now and me with it, that I may go to where the darkness is to face with you the terrible uncertainty of tomorrow, of what will happen, what might happen, what could happen to me and to my children and to my friends, to my job, to my relationships, to my country, all that I cannot see but fantasize, that would prevent but cannot, and so must accept as possibilities. Facing the uncertainty, Lord, grant me the grace to look at it directly and openly and truly, to laugh at it with crazy faith, in the crazy promise that nothing can separate me from your love. To laugh for the joy of it, the joy of these saving surprises that also stir in the darkness, and so trust, despite the dark uncertainty of tomorrow, in the light of my todays, in the cross, and in a kingdom coming. And so I move on and pray on with Jesus. Friends, as we stand on the threshold of this important Lenten season, may we listen for God's voice. May we sing together a song of freedom, a song of hope, a song of transfiguration. May our very lives ring out those grace-filled notes that God first sang to us. And may the notes we sing in unison transform the world around us and make us one. Amen.
We pile up like dry bones, like orphans gathering in burden, we're broken, our defenses fracturing. So break our hearts again.
Friends, as we conclude our service of worship today, I would encourage you, if you haven't already done so, to sign up for our e-newsletter to make sure you're up to date with all the things happening in the life and work of Riverside United Church. We so look forward to partnering with you and many others in that shared work together to make our community a better place, to make our city a better place, to make our world a better place. But friends, today and in the days ahead, I pray that the God of hope may fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you, alongside others, may abound in hope by the power of God's Spirit. Go now in peace. Amen.